Simon & Schuster Audio presents The Winner's Curse, Paradoxes and Anomalies of Economic Life by Richard H. Thaler. Read by Arthur Morey. To Jesse, Maggie, and Greg, My Favorite Anomalies. Chapter 1. Introduction. A friend of yours is the chairman of the Acme Oil Company. He occasionally calls with a problem and asks your advice. This time, the problem is about bidding in an auction. It seems that another oil company has gone into bankruptcy and is forced to sell off some of the land it has acquired for future oil exploration. There is one plot in which Acme is interested. Until recently, it was expected that only three firms would bid for the plot, and Acme intended to bid $10 million. Now they have learned that seven more firms are bidding, bringing the total to 10. The question is, should Acme increase or decrease its bid? What advice do you give? Did you advise bidding more or less? Most people's intuition in this problem is to bid more. After all, there are additional bidders, and if you don't bid more, you won't get this land. However, there is another important consideration that is often ignored. Suppose that each participant in the auction is willing to bid just a little bit less than the amount he or she thinks the land is worth, leaving some room for profits. Of course, no one knows exactly how much oil is in the ground. Some bidders will guess too high, others too low. Suppose, for the sake of argument, that the bidders have accurate estimates on average. Then who will be the person who wins the auction? The winner will be the person who is the most optimistic about the amount of oil in the ground, and that person may well have bid more than the land is worth. This is the dreaded winner's curse. In an auction with many bidders, the winning bidder is often a loser. A key factor in avoiding the winner's curse is bidding more conservatively when there are more bidders. While this may seem counterintuitive, it is the rational thing to do. This book is about economics anomalies, of which the winner's curse is an example. An anomaly is a fact or observation that is inconsistent with the theory. Here, the theory of rational bidding advises bidding less when the number of bidders increases, yet most people would end up bidding more. Two ingredients are necessary to produce a convincing anomaly: a theory that makes crisp predictions and facts that contradict those predictions. In the case of economics anomalies, both ingredients can be difficult to obtain. While there is no shortage of economic theories, the theories are often extremely difficult to pin down. If we can't agree on what the theory predicts, then we can't agree on what constitutes an anomaly. In some cases, economists have, in fact, argued that some theories are simply not testable because they are true by definition. For example, the theory of utility maximization is said to be a tautology. If someone does something, no matter how odd it may seem, it must be utility maximizing, for otherwise the person wouldn't have done it. A theory is indeed not testable if no possible set of data could refute it. In fact, that is not really a theory, more like a definition. However, while many economists have taken comfort in the apparent irrefutability of their theories, others have been busy devising clever tests. And in economics, the following natural law appears to hold: where there are tests, there are anomalies. What is economic theory? The same basic assumptions about behavior are used in all applications of economic analysis, be it the theory of the firm, financial markets, or consumer choice. The two key assumptions are rationality and self-interest. People are assumed to want to get as much for themselves as possible and are assumed to be quite clever in figuring out how best to accomplish this aim. Indeed, an economist who spends a year finding a new solution to a nagging problem, such as the optimal way to search for a job when unemployed, is content to assume that the unemployed have already solved this problem and search accordingly. The assumption that everyone else can intuitively solve problems that an economist has to struggle to solve analytically reflects admirable modesty, but it does seem a bit puzzling. Surely another possibility is that people simply get it wrong. The possibility of cognitive error is of obvious importance in light of what Herbert Simon has called bounded rationality. Think of the human brain as a personal computer, with a very slow processor and a memory system that is both small and unreliable. I don't know about you, but the PC I carry between my ears has more disk failures than I care to think about. What about the other tenet of economic theory, self-interest? Just how selfish are people? The trouble with the standard economic model is illustrated by the behavior exhibited by the drivers in Ithaca, where I live. There is a creek that runs behind Cornell University. The two-way road that crosses this creek is served by a one-lane bridge. At busy times of day, there can be several cars waiting to cross the bridge in either direction. What happens? Most of the time, four or five cars will cross the bridge in one direction, then the next car in line will stop and let a few cars go across the bridge in the other direction. This is a traffic plan that would not work in New York City, nor in an economic model. In New York City, a bridge operating under these rules would, in effect, become one-way, the direction determined by the historical accident of the direction being traveled by the first car to arrive at the bridge. In economic models, people are assumed to be more like New Yorkers than like Ithacans. Is this assumption valid? Fortunately, the cooperative behavior displayed by the Ithaca drivers is not unique. Most of us, even New Yorkers, also donate to charity, clean up campgrounds, and leave tips in restaurants, even those we never plan to visit again. Of course, many of us also cheat on our taxes. They will just waste the money anyway. Overstate losses when making claims to insurance companies, well, just to recover the deductible, and improve the lie of our balls in golf, winter rules in August if no one is looking. We are neither pure saints nor sinners, just human beings. Unfortunately, there aren't many human beings populating the world of economic models. For example, the leading economic model of savings behavior, the life cycle hypothesis, takes no account of the most important human factor entering savings decision-making, self-control. In this model, if you receive a $1,000 windfall, you are expected to save almost all of it since you wish to evenly divide the consumption of the windfall over all of the rest of your remaining years of life. Who needs windfalls if you have to spend them like that? We human beings do other things economists think are weird. Consider this one. You have won two tickets to the Super Bowl, conveniently, for this example, being played in the city where you live. Not only that, but your favorite team is playing. If you are not a football fan, substitute something else that will get you appropriately excited. A week before the game, someone approaches you and asks whether you would be willing to sell your tickets. What is the least you would be willing to accept for them? Assume selling tickets is legal at any price. Now, instead, suppose you do not have two tickets to the Super Bowl, but you have an opportunity to buy them. What is the most you would be willing to pay? For most people, these two answers differ by at least a factor of two. A typical answer is to say that I wouldn't sell the tickets for less than $400 each, but I wouldn't pay more than $200. This behavior may seem reasonable to you, but according to economic theory, your two answers should be almost identical. So the behavior must be considered an anomaly. This is not to say that there is anything wrong with a theory as a theory or model of rational choice. Rationality does imply the near equality of buying and selling prices. The problem is in using the same model to prescribe rational choices and to describe actual choices. If people are not always rational, then we may need two different models for these two distinct tasks. Of course, I am hardly the first to criticize economics for making unrealistic assumptions about behavior. What is new here? To understand how the anomalies illustrated here present a new type of critique of economics, it is useful to review what the prior defenses of economic theory have been. The most prominent defenses of the rational model was offered by Milton Friedman, 1953. Friedman argued that even though people can't make the calculations inherent in the economic model, they act as if they could make the calculations. He uses the analogy of an expert billiards player who doesn't know either physics or geometry, but makes shots as if he could make use of this knowledge. Basically, Friedman's position is that it doesn't matter if the assumptions are wrong if the theory still makes good predictions. In light of this argument, this book stresses the actual predictions of the theory. I find that, assumptions aside, the theory is vulnerable just on the quality of the predictions.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.